Praise the Lord. We thank the Lord for a leadership development session tonight. And I pray that the Lord will take the word and make us more fruitful, more vigilant in the work he has committed into our hands in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for this session. Thank you because you have counted us worthy to be your servants, to be leaders in the church of the living God. We pray that all the responsibility you have given us, reviving the church, helping the church to move forward in the right direction, you grant us the grace to do that consistently, profitably, in Jesus' name. We pray that we ourselves as leaders will be revived, will be renewed, will be transformed, will wake up, and will be watchful. And then you'll use us as instruments in your hand to wake up your church and to make the church stand as the church ought to stand in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. And the people of God said, Amen. Today we're coming to the message of Christ. We're coming to this message that Christ sent to the church. I want to remind you once again that the message is sent to every church, each church is sent to everyone. Because at the end of each message it says, He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. Not just unto this one particular church, one single church. The Spirit says that unto the churches. And tonight we are looking at an important message for our time. That is the end of time. And it is our urgent ministry towards a supposedly living church. Note those words, supposedly living church. We come to Revelation chapter 3 verse 1. And unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, These things says he that has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, I know thy works, that thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead. You have a name that you live. Supposedly you are alive. Supposedly you have Christ in you. Supposedly you have the life of the Spirit. But Jesus said in his evaluation, and Jesus said in his verdict concerning this church, thou art dead. I want you to understand, although the Lord is sending the message to every member of his church, particularly is sending the message to the leader of each local church. It says unto the angel of the church in Sardis, you could put your name there, that is the name of your city, the name of your church, you could put that there, unto the leader, unto the minister, unto the pastor, unto the shepherd, the angel, unto the messenger of the church in Sardis. Here is what you are going to write. These six, says he, that has the seven spirits of God. There's only one Holy Ghost, but that Holy Ghost came in fullness of power, fullness of strength, and fullness of inspiration of the Lord Jesus Christ. So he has the seven spirits of God. You'll discover that in the book of Revelation, that word seven is used frequently many, many times. And the seven represents fullness. It represents completeness. It represents perfection. It's simply saying this is he that has the perfect, the full, the complete, the entire Holy Ghost on him. And the seven churches, that is the seven stars. If you turn back to Revelation chapter 1, we're looking at verse 20. You'll see what the Lord himself said concerning the seven stars. It says, the mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. Look at this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest at the seven churches. So you understand, the stars represent the angels of the churches. And the Lord said, I have the seven stars in my hand, and I have the seven spirits of God upon me, within me, around me, influencing me, inspiring me, and leading me on. And he says everything he says by the light, by the illumination of the perfect full spirit of God upon him. As we come to this passage, Revelation chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. Let's read now, Revelation chapter 3 from verse 1. And unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things says he that has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. In verse 2 it says, be watchful and strengthen the things that remain and that are ready to die. They are dying, they are not fully dead yet, that is, these ones that remain, they are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. In verse 3 it says, remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou, the pastor, if therefore thou, the messenger of the church, the angel of the church, if therefore thou, the leader, the shepherd, and the minister in the church, if therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. And now he says something encouraging, for even this church thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. In verse 5 it says, he that overcometh, always he that overcometh, there's no promise of reward for the compromiser. There's no promise of reward for the sinning minister and for the careless pastor. It says, he that overcometh, the pastor that overcomes, the minister that overcomes, the member of the church that overcomes, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. The same shall be clothed. That means it's a promise for the future, a promise after he has been pronounced over an overcomer. The same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name on condition that he overcomes, on condition that he keeps overcoming, on condition that he is an overcomer, he is a victor, he is a conqueror. On that condition, I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess him. I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Now he concludes and he applies the message to you and to me. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. As I said, the message tonight is our urgent ministry towards a supposedly living church. There are three things we're going to consider. Number one, recognizing the dynamic sevenfold spirit in Christ. The Lord Jesus Christ introduced himself and he says he is the one that has the seven spirits of God. And we need to recognize what Christ has said about himself, recognizing the dynamic sevenfold spirit in Christ. Point number two, reviving dead, slumbering souls in the church. When Jesus said, you have a name that thou livest, but thou art dead, it's referring to the church in general, the majority of that church, that is, the majority of members in the church, were actually spiritually dead. They were dead spiritual souls. And he says the pastor of that church, the leader, the minister in that church must wake up that church, must revive that church, must resuscitate the church, must bring spiritual life into that church, into those dead, sleeping, slumbering souls in the church. That's our responsibility. That's why we have the urgent ministry. That's why he's sending us forth. We're not just hearing the word. He speaks to us as angels, as messengers of the church. And he says, this is what to do if we find our church in this condition, reviving dead, slumbering souls in the church. Point number three, reassuring disciples, steadfast saints who conquer. Those who conquer, and those who are conquering, those who are overcoming, those who are living the upright life, and they still have the life of Christ in them. We're assuring them, we're encouraging them, we're bringing the promise of God unto them, and we're discipling them to remain steadfast as saints who conquer. Point number one now, we come to the recognition of Christ, the dynamic sevenfold spirit in Christ. And you look at that, Revelation chapter 3, verse 1 again. And unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, this thing says he that has the seven spirits of God. This thing says he that has the seven spirits of God. Actually, if you look at Revelation chapter 1, reading from verse 4. Revelation chapter 1, verse 4, he had said the same thing, John, to the seven churches which are in Asia Minor. Grace be unto you and peace from him, this is from Christ, from him which is and which was and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne. It says from the seven spirits which are before his throne. It mentions the throne there. Let's come to Revelation chapter 4, and we're looking at verse 5. In Revelation chapter 4, verse 5, it says, and out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices. And there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne. Those seven lamps burning represent the full and the complete and the perfect spirit of God, which are the seven spirits of God. It tells us in chapter 5 and verse 6, that is Revelation chapter 5 verse 6, it says, and I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, the living creatures, and in the midst of the elders stood a lamp. That's the lamp of God that takes away the sin of the world. That's the lamp of God that was smitten for us and slain for us. That's the lamp of God that presented his blood for our redemption and for our salvation and for our cleansing and for our purifying, our purification and for our sanctification. A lamb as if it had been slain, having seven horns, perfect power, seven horns, perfect authority, seven horns, perfect strength, and seven eyes, perfect understanding, perfect intelligence, and perfect knowledge of everything, about everyone, anywhere and everywhere. And it says, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. Seven spirits of God, the perfect spirit of God, the Holy Spirit of God sent forth into all the world. As we look at this introduction of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you want to recognize the dynamic sevenfold spirit in Christ. Let's talk about this under three perspectives. Number one, the sevenfold perfection of the spirit on Christ. It tells us in that Revelation chapter 3 verse 1 again, it says Revelation chapter 3 verse 1, and unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things says he that has, that possesses, that has in him, that has upon him, that has with him, going along with him. It says Christ has the seven spirits of God. As I told you already, seven means perfection. Seven means completeness. And seven means the fullness of the Spirit of God. Let's look at this then, the sevenfold perfection of the Spirit in Christ and on Christ. In Isaiah chapter 11, reading from verse 1, talking about Christ in the language of prophecy. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch. Have you noticed that? Capital B is talking about Christ. And a branch shall grow out of his roots. In verse 2 it says, and the Spirit of the Lord one shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom 2, the Spirit of understanding 3, the Spirit of counsel 4, the Spirit of might 5, the Spirit of knowledge 6, the Spirit of the fear of the Lord 7. Although you have the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of God, the same Spirit, but looking at the seven aspects and the full perfect aspect of that Spirit of God. In John chapter 3, verse 34, it tells us about the fullness of the Spirit. It tells us about the completeness of the Spirit and the perfection of the Spirit on the Lord Jesus Christ. In John chapter 3, verse 34, it says, for he whom God has sent speaketh the words of God. Look at this. For God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him. That is, the Lord, the Father, did not have just measure the Spirit and give him a part and give him a little and give him temporarily. He gave him the Spirit without measure. Now, let's see the symbolism of the seven spirits of God, the emblems of the seven spirits of God, the portrayals of the seven spirits of God. This leads us now to the second part, the seven portrayals, the seven emblems, the seven symbols of the Spirit for completeness. Number one is shown to us as water. In John chapter 7, verse 38 and verse 39, he that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow, look at this, rivers of living water. In verse 39, it says, but they spake he of the Spirit. It says rivers of living water, and yet it says they spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. He calls him the Spirit, he calls him the Holy Ghost, and then he represents him with water. It's represented by fire. If you look at Matthew chapter 3, verse 11, in Matthew chapter 3, verse 11, it says of the Lord Jesus Christ that indeed I baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. There the Holy Ghost is revealed to us, is portrayed to us as fire. The fire that burns every chaff, and the fire that makes us fervent to the Lord. Number one, as water. Number two, as fire. Number three, as oil. In 1 Samuel chapter 16, reading from verse 13, it talks about David. When the Holy Ghost came upon David, he was emblemized, he was portrayed as the oil. That's why it says, then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. And the Spirit of the Lord emblemized and symbolized and depicted and represented and portrayed with that oil. The Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day. And the Spirit of God is shown as wind. That's why Jesus said in John chapter 3, reading from verse 8, the Spirit of God as wind, he tells us in John chapter 3, looking at verse 8, the wind bloweth where he listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. Look at this. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. The wind bloweth, the wind cometh and refreshes everything and brings new life and brings vitality and makes vegetation and everything to be what it ought to be and to be productive. And then Jesus said, I speak about the action of the wind, and so is everyone that is born of the Spirit. And of course, you understand, the Spirit of God is revealed as a dove. In Matthew chapter 3, reading from verse 16. Matthew chapter 3, verse 16. Here Jesus Christ was coming out of the water of baptism. And as he came out of the water of baptism, here is what we are told in Matthew chapter 3, verse 16. And Jesus, when he was baptized, he went up straightway out of the water, out of that river from where he was baptized. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God, look at this, descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And the Spirit of God is represented to us like a guide in John chapter 16. John chapter 16, here we're reading from verse 13. In John chapter 16, verse 13, it says, howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, the Spirit of truth is come, he will guide you into all truth. And for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come. He is the guide. And then he is the seal. The seal. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. Ephesians chapter 4, reading from verse 30, it says, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God. It's the Holy Spirit whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Therefore, when you hear Jesus say, thus says he that has the seven spirits of God, is talking about the various portrayals and the seven emblems of the Spirit of God as water, as fire, as oil, as wind, as dove, as guide, as seal. Now, we come to Revelation chapter 3, verse 1. It says in Revelation chapter 3, reading from verse 1, it says, unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things saith he that has the seven spirits of God. Hold on there for a moment. You know, we who are Christians, we who are born again, we who are children of God, we also have the Spirit of God upon us. In fact, it says that when we are born again, it says, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot see, he cannot enter into the kingdom. And then he tells us too that we are saved and we are sanctified by the Spirit of God. To them who are preserved, and to them who are beloved, and to them who are sanctified by the Spirit of God, were sanctified by the Spirit of God. It says the Lord has called us unto holiness by his Spirit. Well, then it means that we're saved, we have the Spirit of God. In fact, it says, whosoever does not have the Spirit of God is none of his. The Spirit of God is involved in our salvation. The Spirit of God is involved in our sanctification. And the Spirit of God is involved in our baptism. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and to the uttermost part of the earth. Well, then, what description can we give concerning the Spirit of God upon us? This brings us to the third part of this point one, the sevenfold presence of the Spirit in Christians. Number one is the Spirit of life. In Romans chapter 8, reading from verse 2. In Romans chapter 8, verse 2, it says, "For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, has made me free from the law of sin and death." We're born again, we're saved, we become children of God, and it sets us free. And the power that sets us free and makes us to live a life free from sin is the Spirit of life in Christ that sets us free from the law of sin and death. In fact, it says in verse 9, "But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you." The Spirit of God, the Spirit of life. Now, if anyone have not the Spirit of Christ, is none of his. As we are born again and we belong to the Lord, we have the Spirit of life. And that Spirit of life quickens us. Look at verse 11. It says in verse 11, "But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you." It is that Spirit that actually bears witness with our heart that we're the children of God. And by that Spirit of God, we're calling Father, Abba, Father. Look at verse 15. In verse 15, it says, "For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received," look at this, "the Spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father." Number two is the Spirit of holiness. And it is that Spirit of holiness that brings us into the kingdom, that brings us into the ministry. It tells us in Romans chapter 1, looking at verse 4. Romans chapter 1, verse 4, "And declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness." According to the Spirit of holiness, as the Holy Ghost, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. And then in verse 5, it says, "By that Spirit by whom we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name." The Spirit of life, the Spirit of holiness, the Spirit of truth. It tells us in John chapter 14, we're reading from verse 17. It says, "Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you." The Spirit of truth. Chapter 15, we're reading from verse 26. Chapter 15, verse 26, it tells us, "But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father," look at this, "even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me." In chapter 16 of John, verse 13, it says, chapter 16, verse 13, "How be it when he," the Holy Ghost, "when he," the Holy Spirit, "when he," the Spirit of truth, "is come, he will guide you into all truth." He'll not guide you into error. It's the Spirit of truth. He'll not guide you into falsehood. It's the Spirit of truth. Because it's the Spirit of truth, when he is come, if you have him, if you have received him, if he abides in you, if he dwells in you, he shall guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, for he, and he will show you things to come. Is also the Spirit of wisdom. The Spirit of wisdom. It tells us in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. The minister needs him as the spirit of wisdom and revelation. When you read the Bible, for you to have the revelation, the illumination, the inspiration, the understanding of that word of God, we need the Spirit, because it's the author that inspired the word of God. And if you have that spirit of wisdom and that spirit of revelation, it'll refresh you, it'll renew you, it'll revive you while you read the word. And when you're ministering to your congregation, the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of revelation in the knowledge of him. It tells us in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, that he is the spirit of power, the spirit of power. In 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, for God has not given us the spirit of fear. Hold on. If we have a spirit of fear, it's not just fear, it's a spirit of fear. And if anyone has a spirit of fear, you can tell who gave him, who gave her that spirit. God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power. That means the spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. It's also the spirit of glory. It tells us in 1 Peter chapter 4, reading from verse 14. 1 Peter chapter 4, reading from verse 14. If ye be reproached in persecution, if ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye. For the spirit of glory and the spirit of God, the spirit of God is the spirit of glory. The Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit is the spirit of glory and of God, resteth upon you. On their part, he is evil spoken of, but on your part, he is glorified. Not only that, the spirit of grace, the spirit of grace. In Hebrews chapter 10, reading from verse 29, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 29, how much sore punishment suppose ye shall he be thought worthy who has trodden underfoot the Spirit of God, the Son of God, and has counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing. Listen to this. And he has done despite unto the Spirit of grace, the Spirit of grace, the Spirit of grace. When we possess, when we have that Spirit of grace, you know what it does? It gives us abundant grace. Grace for the ministry, and grace in every situation, and grace to withstand whatever may be coming upon our lives because of the ministry. That's why the Lord said to Paul the Apostle in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, reading from verse 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, looking at verse 9, and he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. My grace is sufficient for thee. How? Because he has the spirit of grace. And when you have, when I have, when we have the spirit of grace, this is what will happen. That grace of God will be sufficient for us, whatever the challenge and whatever the situation. My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. We understand then when the Lord spoke about the seven spirits of God, he's talking about the sevenfold spirit on him. He's talking about the seven portrayals of the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit on him. He's also talking about the sevenfold presence of the Spirit in Christians. And I pray that this spirit of life, spirit of holiness, spirit of truth, and spirit of wisdom, spirit of power, spirit of glory, and spirit of grace will abide in you and will be sufficient for you in all the duty that the Lord has given you in Jesus' name. We're coming back now to Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, and we're coming to point number 2. Revelation chapter 3, and we're coming to point number 2. And this is reviving dead, slumbering souls in the church. This is our duty. The Lord is not going to, you know, just do that without your cooperation and without your own fulfilling the condition of the church being revived. You know, it's good to pray when you sometimes find people, oh Lord, revive your church, revive your church, revive your church. That's right, that's right. He can do it, but you have a part to play. Habakkuk said, in the midst of the years, revive thy work, O God. So it's all right to pray, revive thy church and revive your work. But if we only pray and we do not do what the Lord has told us to do, the church will not be revived, and the life that ought to come, the vital life and the reviving life and the great life and the propelling life and the life of Christ in the church will not be revealed. You need to do your part. I need to do my part. Unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things saith he that has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. Look at verse 2. It says in verse 2, be watchful. That's your urgent responsibility. Be watchful. There's personal watchfulness. There's pastoral watchfulness. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. For I have not found thy works perfect before God. And then he says in verse 3, remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou pastor, thou minister, thou shepherd, if therefore thou leader shall not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. There are three things we're looking at here as we talk about reviving dead, slumbering souls in the church. Number one, the description of dead nominal members. There were nominal members in this church in Sardis. They had a name that they lived, but they were dead. And those dead nominal members have their description in the Word of God. Look at Revelation chapter 3, verse 1, the last part that says, thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead. Who can we refer to as dead members of the church? They are coming to the church. They profess to be members of the church. They identify with the church. You count them as part of the church. And they are, in a way. But their spiritual lives are dead. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1. Ephesians chapter 2, we're looking at verse 1. And you are see quickened who were dead in trespasses and sins. Members of the church who are dead in trespasses and sins, all their peculiar sins, all their evil habits, all their defilement, they remain in them, they enjoy them. They're like the swine that falls into the dead and will rule and enjoy even the dead. They're like the dogs that go back into their vomit and they see nothing wrong in it at all, and their conscience does not prick them because they are dead in trespasses and sins. It tells us in verse 2. In verse 2, it says, wherein in time past he walked according to the course of this world. Those who are dead in trespasses and sins, they walk according to the precepts of the world. They walk according to the principles and the practices of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit of the devil and the spirit of the antichrist and the spirit of the evil one controls them, because they walk according to the prince of the power of the air, The spirit that now walketh in the children of disobedience, it tells us in verse 3, it says, among whom also we had a conversation before we were born again in times past in the lust of the flesh. Those who live in the lust of the flesh, they live by the feeling of the flesh. Once their flesh desires something, lusts after something, they go after that, and they do not have the power, they do not have the strength to resist temptation. They walk in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. Those are the people. If they are members of our church or members of any church, is supposedly living church, is supposedly Bible-believing church, but they are living in sin, they are dead in trespasses and sins. Look at verse 12. It says in verse 12 that at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope without God in this world. The first part of the sentence says without Christ, and the last part says without God in this world. Those who do not have the love of God in their heart, they don't have the word of God in their hearts, they don't have the propelling power of the Spirit of God in their lives, they do not have the grace of Christ in their lives, they do not have the life of Christ, the faith of Christ in their lives. They are without Christ, they are without God, they are without the Spirit, they are dead members of the church. And such members, after they die like that spiritually, and they do not have the life of Christ and the life of God in them, they also wonder about, you know, they are sometimes here today and they are in another place, another time. They don't know the difference. The dead does not know the difference between good and bad and between upright and, you know, a downtrodden. And they wonder about, in fact, it says in Proverbs chapter 21, reading from verse 16, Proverbs chapter 21, reading from verse 16, the man that wandereth out of the way of understanding shall remain in the congregation of the dead. There's a congregation the Bible calls the congregation of the dead. As a congregation, they might sing. As a congregation, they might stand. As a congregation, they might kneel down. As a congregation, they might have, you know, some interaction together. But because they do not have the life of Christ and the life of God and the life of the Spirit and the Spirit of life in them, they are the congregation of the dead. And those who wander about, like prodigal son, like prodigal daughter, those who wander about and they go to falsehood and they go to, you know, all these assemblies that do not have the living word of God and do not lay by the living word of Christ, they go to the congregation of the dead. They are dead, and the congregations they go to, they are also dead, and they have no way of coming out of that except to run after them and reach out to them and wake them up and alert them and make them to repent and make them to feel conviction for their sin and call upon the Lord and come back. It tells us in James chapter 2, reading from verse 17, there are people that will say, you know, I have faith, but they have nothing to show for that kind of faith. And it says, even so faith, if it has not works, if it has not character, if it has not the proper comportment and the proper conduct and the conduct and the character that matches that profession in Christ, even so faith, if it has not works, is dead, being alone. Sometimes you ask somebody, are you born again? I said, Pastor, you are asking me. I've been in the church all this a long time. I'm a member of the church. That's not the question. Are you born again? Are you a child of God? Are you alive in Christ? Well, you know, I have faith, and the faith I have, anytime I'm sick and I read, I get healed. I have faith anytime I have any challenge and I call on our pastor, whether he's praying on phone or he's praying for me directly, I just believe. And because of that, you know, I have faith. I'm a child of God. That's not the faith we're talking about. Does your faith bring forth the fruit of the Spirit? Does it bring out love and peace and joy and long-suffering and meekness and temperance, self-control? Does it bring forth a gentleness? Does it bring forth the character of a real child of God? That's what we're talking about, because even so faith, if it has not works, is dead, being alone. It tells us in verse 20. In verse 20 it says, "But wilt thou know, O vain man, O vain woman, O vain member, wilt thou know, O professing man, professing woman, professing member of the church, that faith without works is dead?" Faith without works is dead. It tells us in verse 26. It says, "For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works, without character, without charity, without the life of the Christian, so faith without corresponding action is dead also." What's our duty then? What do you do, brother? What do you do, sister? As a leader, as a minister, what do you do to the people that are in the church and they profess that they live, but they are not alive in Christ? Number two, our duty towards dying negligent members. If you look at Revelation chapter 3, it tells us in verse 2, be watchful. Not only that, strengthen the things that remain, that are ready to die. For I have not found thy works perfect before God. And then in verse 3, it tells us in verse 3, it says, remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast, and repent. If thou therefore shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. You know what he's telling us to do as a duty? Number one, watch. It tells us in that verse 2, it says, watch. You must have, number one, personal watchfulness. Personal watchfulness on your own, on your own family, on your own life, on your own character, on your own utterances, on your own behavior, on your own ministry, on your own calling. Be watchful. Be watchful. Are you doing what the Lord has called you to do? Are you concentrating on what the Lord has appointed for you to do? Are you occupied in the one single work he has committed into your hand? And is it bringing forth fruit? Personal watchfulness. Not only that, pastoral watchfulness. In pastoral watchfulness, you watch over the members of the flock. You watch over the members of the congregation. You watch over the members of the assembly. It tells us in Proverbs chapter 27 and verse 23. It's your pastoral watchfulness now. And this is how you watch over members of the family and members of the local church. Be thou diligent to know the state of thy flocks, and look well to thy herds, and look well to thy herds. It tells us in Isaiah chapter 52, reading from verse 1, Isaiah chapter 52, and we're looking at verse 1, awake, awake, put on thy strength, O Zion. If you are going to be watchful, you have to put on your strength, because if you see anything to be corrected, if you see anyone that is dead or dying, and you are going to revive them, and you are going to bring them forth, you are not going to do that with physical strength. You are going to do that with spiritual strength, spiritual anointing, and with the word of God that brings conviction. You have to be awake yourself, awake, Awake, put on thy strength, O Zion. Put on thy beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city. For henceforth there shall no more come into thee the uncircumcised and the unclean. That's the watchfulness. That you'll not allow the uncircumcised in heart, uncircumcised in tongue, uncircumcised in character, uncircumcised in behavior, a pagan, a heathen, to come in and pollute the assembly of the living God. You'll not allow the unclean and the people that will dampen the zeal of the people, the people that will kill, spiritually kill and destroy the members of the congregation. It says in verse 2, it says, shake thyself from the dust. If you're a minister, you're going to wake up the children of God. You're going to wake up the members who are slumbering. You're going to wake up those who are dying or those who are dead. You yourself must be awake. You shake thyself from the dust. Arise, sit down, O Jerusalem. Loose thyself from the bands of thy neck. If you are bound yourself, if you are tied yourself, your hands are tied, your feet are tied, your neck has the bands, you'll not have the liberty, you'll not have the freedom to do what you have to do your duty, and wake up the people who are asleep. It says, you will loose yourself from the bands of your neck, O captive daughter of Zion. It tells us in Ephesians chapter 5, we're looking at verse 14. Ephesians chapter 5, and we're looking at verse 14. Wherefore, he says, awake, thou that sleepest. And we who are children of God and we who are servants of the Lord, we must not be sleeping and slumbering, and we're so tired. And every time we're sleeping physically and spiritually, and there's so much sleep, it says, awake, thou that sleepest. We must not allow our souls to sleep, our spirit to sleep, our inner man to sleep. We must be awake every time and be vigilant every time. Awake, thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. And Christ shall give thee light. It tells us, you remember in Revelation chapter 3 and verse 2, it says, be watchful and strengthen those things that remain. Strengthen those things that remain. When you prepare your message as a minister, you ask yourself, will this strengthen the church? Will this wake up the church? Will this alert the church? Will this alarm the unconverted? Will this give a helping hand and raise up the people who are sleeping? Will this give energy and power and sustenance to the people who are stumbling, or to the people who are dying? The Lord said, this is our duty, strengthen the things that remain that are ready to die. He doesn't say club them, kill them, destroy them. You know, instead of waking them up, and instead of helping them, lifting them up, instead of strengthening them, there are preachers that have the tendency to kill and to destroy and to put to death those who are dying already. It says, don't do that. Don't be a contributing factor to the backsliding of anyone. Don't be a contributing factor to the death of those who are not dead yet, who are ready to die, who are dying. Strengthen the things that remain. It tells us in Acts chapter 18, verse 23. Acts of the Apostles chapter 18, verse 23. After he had spent some time there, what does that mean? Spending time with those you need to preach to. Spending time with those you need to awaken. Spending time with those you need to arouse. Spending time with those you need to revive. You know, if the pastor, if the overseer, region overseer, state overseer, or national overseer is far away, And, you know, members cannot see him, members cannot contact him, and he cannot contact the members. He is far away over there, whatever he's doing there. For whatever he's seen, it says he, when he has spent some time there, you must spend time with the people. If you have interest, the interests of the people, if you have the love of the people at heart, and if you want them to be who they ought to be, if they will not be like sheep without a shepherd, if will not be like a church without a pastor, after he had spent some time there, he departed and went over all the country. Underline that in your Bible. If you have, if you're a group pastor and you have a district under you, went over all the country. You visit them one by one. And there are some of our states now, the lockdown is over, and we can move here and there. And even where the lockdown is not totally over, we can move in the afternoon, and you can check up on this physically, check up on that physically. He went over all the country. He reached an overseer looking at all the local governments and checking up on them and seeing how they do. It's not what did you eat, what didn't you eat. We're talking about spiritual oversight. We're talking about looking at the spiritual condition, whether they're still saved and righteous and they're holding on and they are firm in the Lord. And he went over all the country. He reached an overseer going to all those local governments. He stayed overseer checking up on all the groups in the city and all the districts in the city and all those regions in the state. And he national overseer doing the same thing and went over all the country of the of Galatia and Phrygia in order one by one. And he does that in order, not disorderly, strengthening all the disciples, strengthening all the disciples. That's our duty. And he wants us to do that duty, to those who are dead, and to those who are dying, and to those who are still alive, and for those who are still awake in the Lord. You have a duty, and the Lord wants you to carry that out with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, and with all the energy and all the wisdom you have at your command. In number three now, number three talks about its directives for dedicated nursing ministers. When we talk about nursing minister, you understand what it means to nurse. When a woman has delivered a child, she nurses that child. If she abandons the child, not feeding the child, if she abandons the child, not giving milk to the child, if she abandons the child, not nursing, not nourishing, not taking care of that child, that neglect alone, even if that child were healthy and strong, that neglect alone can kill that child. And look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 7. Here Paul the apostle talks about himself as a minister. And he says, but we were gentle among you, even as, look at this, we like Paul, we like Timothy, we like Titus, and we like Luke, and we like Silas, we who are ministers, we were gentle among you. We were men, and yet even as a nurse cherishes her children. That's why we can talk of the minister as a nursing minister. Look at verse 8. In verse 8, it tells us, so be affectionately desirous of you, we were willing to have imparted unto you not the gospel of God only, but also our own souls, because ye were dear unto us. Underline that in your Bible. If the members of the church are dear unto the pastor will nurse them, the pastor will encourage them, the pastor will build them up, the pastor will nurture them, the pastor will feed them with the appropriate spiritual food at the right time, because ye were dear unto us. If the souls are important and they're dear to the pastor, he will not abandon them and travel far away and just overlook the needs of the church for such a long time. It says, because we're willing to impart unto you not just the word of God, even our very souls, because you are dear unto us. It says in verse 10, it says, how ye are witnesses, and God also, how holily and justly and unblameably we behaved ourselves among you, staying with them among you, abiding with them among you, taking care of them, and showing and revealing and demonstrating that spiritual life before those members and before those disciples. We behaved ourselves among you that believe. What's the directive of the Lord Jesus Christ to us who are nursing ministers in the church of the living God? Let's come back to Revelation chapter 3, verse 3. It says, in Revelation chapter 3, verse 3, it says, but remember, number one is to remember. You know, if we don't remember how we received the ministry, the excitement we had in those early years of the ministry, and the passion we had in those early years of ministry, and the duty, the way we carried out our duty, those early years of ministry, and the way we were eager to attend the workers' training and workers' retreat, and the way we were eager to attend even the Congress, and the way we prepared our minds. If we don't remember how we received and how we heard, we'll just continue, you know, that same sluggish way that is bringing death, and we will not do what we need to do. It says, remember therefore how thou hast received, and hold fast. He wants us to retain what we've got. He doesn't want us to just, you know, hold everything with a loose end. Hold fast every doctrine we have received and every challenge we have received, every duty we have got. He says, hold fast. He wants you to hold fast your conviction. He wants you to hold fast the doctrines of the Word of God. He wants you to hold fast your duty. He wants you to hold fast your responsibility. He wants us, number one, to remember. He wants us, number two, to retain. And then he says, hold fast and repent. Hold fast and repent. He wants us to repent. What does that mean? You say, but you know, I've not committed sin. Maybe you have not committed sin. But how about a mother that neglects to feed the new baby, and the baby is sick, and the baby is dying, and she has not committed sin, but she is not giving a food to the child, is not giving appropriate nutrients to the child, and the child is dying, and the child is crying, and then she turns, you know, the other way until the child died and said, I didn't touch him, I didn't touch the child, I didn't beat the child, I didn't stab the child. But you stabbed the child until the child died. What is sin if that is not sin? If that negligence is not sin, what is sin? It's telling also our pastors, it's telling also our ministers, it says we should repent of our negligence, we should repent of our sluggishness, and we should wake up and arise and feed the people and strengthen the people. Then it says, return with all our heart, we return unto God, and with all our soul, we return unto Christ, and with all our commitment again, we gather ourselves together, we return to the ministry with all our heart, all our soul, and all our mind. We return so we can take care of the people of the Lord. And number five is to renew. We renew our strength. We renew our consecration. We lay everything upon the altar again. Renew, and we reveal everything we heard in the meeting, everything we've read in the Word of God, and we keep on reading, and we keep on searching, and we keep on delving into the Word of life, so that we can reveal that, we can give to the children of God and the people of God, and then we come back to the people, the workers who are to work with us. We retrain them what we have heard among many witnesses, that we give unto faithful men and faithful women, faithful workers, and the faithful house fellowship leaders, who will be able to teach, who will be able to feed, who will be able to inspire, who will be able to follow up on others also. That's the directive he has given, and I pray we will not be negligent. You and I will not be negligent in Jesus' name. We come to point number three now. In point number three is reassuring disciples, steadfast saints who conquer. You want to resolve saints who conquer. You want to reassure saints who conquer. You don't want to have members that every temptation floors them, gets them down, defeats them, and destroys them. You don't want to be a minister that is not taking care of the children of God, not taking care of the workers in the vineyard, not taking care of the people that surround you, the people that are working with you, and you are not reassuring them. You are not discipling them. You are not building them up. You are not feeding them. You are not following up on them. The Lord has given us the responsibility that we have the duty. He has given us the directives that we will reassure, we will disciple and make the saints of God and make the servants of God to conquer. Three things we're looking at. Number one, the preservation of worthy undefiled saints. Look at Revelation chapter 3 verse 4. In Revelation chapter 3 verse 4, thou hast a few names even in Sardis. You understand? Even in Sardis, although the church was dying, although the church had a name that they lived but are dead, although the church had a lot of people that are ready to die, and they were not dead yet but they were to be strengthened, yet in that church there were a few names, and those few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments. And it says, they shall walk with me in white, but they are worthy. They have not defiled their garments. It's not talking about the outer garment, the physical, natural clothes that we wear. It's talking about spiritual clothing. It's talking about what we're put on as our clothing. Look at Revelation chapter 16, and we're reading from verse 15. Revelation chapter 16, and we're reading from verse 15. It says, behold, I come as a thief. I'll come suddenly. I'll come quickly. I'll come when unexpected. I'm coming soon. Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. He's talking of the garment and the robe of righteousness. In Revelation chapter 19, Revelation chapter 19, we're reading from verse 7. In Revelation chapter 19, verse 7, it tells us of this garment and it tells us of this robe. It says, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage supper, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife has made herself ready. His wife has made herself ready. The bride of Christ has made herself ready. In verse 8, it talks about the garment. In verse 8, and to her was granted that she should be arrayed, clothed, covered in fine linen, clean and white. Look at this. For the fine linen, the garment, is the righteousness of the saints. And it says, a righteousness must not be defiled. A righteousness must not be stained. A righteousness must not be soiled. We must be walking in character pure and holy and righteous. In Psalm 119, Psalm 119, we're looking at verse 1. It says in Psalm 119, verse 1, it says, blessed are the undefiled in the way. In the way, as we're walking in this world, as we're living in this world, blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. In verse 2, it says, in verse 2, blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart. He tells us in verse 3, he says in verse 3, they also do no iniquity, the people who are worthy and the people who are defiled and the people who remain holy and saintly. He says they also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. How will that happen? Let's look at verse 9 of that Psalm 119, verse 9. Wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. We feed them, we nourish them, we nurture them with the word of God. And we keep the children of God, the people of God, to remain worthy, waiting, getting ready for the coming of the Lord. What's the promise he has given to his people, to his children? The promise for watchful, unblameable stewards. We're coming to Revelation chapter 3, verse 5. In Revelation chapter 3, reading from verse 5, it says, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. This is saying, they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. I'll give them white raiment. And it says, they shall be clothed with white in white raiment. And I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. When he comes and the rapture takes place, when he comes and he takes the people of God away, the people he will take away, they'll be clothed in white raiment because they have overcome. Look at Revelation chapter 7, and we're reading from verse 9. Revelation chapter 7, we're reading from verse 9. And after this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed, look at that, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. And then he tells us in verse 10, he says, and he cried and cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb. In verse 11, it says, and all the angels stood round about the throne, and about the elders, and the four beasts fell before the throne on their faces and worshipped God. In verse 12, it says, and saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. Amen. Verse 13, look at the question. And one of the elders answered, saying unto me, what are these which are arrayed in white robes? Who are these who are clothed, arrayed in white robes? And whence came they? Those who will be arrayed in white clothes, and who will put on the white garment, and who will walk with Christ in white garment. Look at verse 14. And said unto him, sir, thou knowest. And he says unto me, these are they which are come out of great tribulation, out of great trials, out of great temptation, out of great problems, out of great suffering, out of great persecution. And they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. He's talking about those who are cleansed in the blood of the Lamb. They are washed in the blood of the Lamb. Their character, their conduct, their comportment, their consecration, their lifestyle, everything is according to the pattern Christ has laid down. And they are cleansed and washed and purged in the blood of the Lamb. And it says in verse 15, it says, therefore are they before the throne of God, and serve him day and night in his temple. And he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. Verse 16, And he says, and they shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. And now in verse 17, it says, for the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them unto living fountains of waters, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Now, let's come back to Revelation chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 5 and verse 6. The privilege of unspeakable splendor, wonderful, unspeakable splendor. When we cross over and we cross over the river of death, or we cross over and we're raptured and taken to be with the Lord, and we have overcome and all temptations passed, all trials passed, all tribulations passed, all persecution passed, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life. When we become Christians, when we're born again, the Lord assures us that we should rejoice because our names are written in the book of life in heaven. And because we are continually and consistently walking in with the Lord and in the Lord, he says our name will remain there. Because the Lord said, only when somebody has sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book which I have written. But as we consistently overcome, as we consistently live by faith, and we live like Christ wanted us to live, he says, I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. What he promised the Lord has given us. And now he says in verse 6, he says, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. He that has an ear, what kind of ear? A listening ear. He that has a listening ear, let him hear. What kind of ear? He that has an obedient ear. An obedient ear, that's the one that will hear, and immediately and promptly and correctly, he will obey the word of God. He that has an obedient ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. He that has an ear, what kind of ear? He that has a circumcised ear. You know, the Lord accused the children of Israel that their ears were uncircumcised because their hearts were uncircumcised. But now you see, you know, we come to the Lord and then we have a circumcised ear, a cleansed ear, an obedient ear. And it says, he that has a circumcised ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. He wants us to have a listening ear. He wants us to have an obedient ear. He wants us to have a circumcised ear. He wants us to have a cleansed heart, a circumcised heart. He wants us to obey the word of God, hearken to the word of God promptly, hearken to the word of God. He wants us to have a respectful ear. We respect the word and the one who has spoken the word, Christ, unto us. We have a believing ear. We believe his word because he has spoken to us. He that has a believing ear, a respectful ear, a submissive ear, he that has that obedient ear, circumcised ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. And then he says, give us this privilege that we'll walk with him in white, because he'll make us worthy. And we'll call upon the Lord. We'll stand up now, brother. Let's stand up, sister. Let's stand up and look at the word of God today. You're a minister. You're a leader. You're a man of God. You're a woman of God. And he has given an urgent responsibility into your hands. And he has said, we should wake up. We should awaken the slumbering church, the supposedly living church, and the dying church, and those who are dead members in the church, wake them up by the word of God. lift up your voice like a trumpet, that the people who are dead or dying may wake up. And you will pray as well that the voice of Christ will sound an alarm in the ears of all our members, and they will understand Christ is coming and is coming sooner, and they will not continue to slumber. They will not continue to sleep. They will not remain in spiritual darkness. And those who have been wandering away from this to this, let's warn them. Let's alert them. Let's call them back from the far country into which they have wandered. And let us be watchful. Watchful over ourselves. Watchful over the congregation. Let us strengthen those things that remain. Let us make an effort, intelligent effort, that will strengthen the things that remain, that are ready to die. And let us see how to perfect the work the Lord has committed into our hands. For he says, I have not found thy work perfect before me. Let us perfect the imperfection. Warn every man, teach every man, that you and I, that we may present every man perfect before the Lord. And he tells us to remember how we received, how you received the word of God, the excitement you had when you first received, and the diligence you had when you first received, and the way you looked at the state of the flock when you first received, and the way you loved them, and the way you took care of them, and the way you prepared your messages, and the way you were fully prepared, and you delivered the message to attract and to alarm and to stir up and to quicken the people that need spiritual life in them. Let's remember how we received and heard. It says, let us repent. It says, let us return. Let us return fully back into our ministry, fully back into what the Lord wants us to do. And let us renew our consecration. Let us renew every sin we have given to the Lord. And anyone that is, any sin that is dying out, let their revival come in your soul, in your spirit, and in the ministry. And let us reveal the might of God to the church at every opportunity. Every opportunity, let us reveal the might of God unto the church, and let us retrain our people. If our people are getting slower, the most sluggish now, COVID-19 has dampened all their zeal, and the zeal to even come and congregate when the lockdown is over, that zeal, if it's dying down, wake them up, follow up on them. Run after them, call them, visit them, and retrain the people. Don't drive them away. Retrain the people. Don't say, well, if they don't want to hear, that's their good luck. Retrain the people. Let their souls and let their ministries, their stewardship, be very important unto you. And you're willing to impart not the gospel only, but your very soul unto them. Assure them that if we stay faithful, if we abide faithful, assure them that if we remain in the calling the Lord has given us and we remain overcomers, if we remain conquering, that the Lord himself will give us what he has promised. We shall walk with him in white robes, undefiled, will be among the myriads and the millions of saints of God who have not defiled their garments, and will shout amen, will shout blessing, will shout glory, will shout salvation unto our God who has taken us out of all those predicaments and problems, and has made us to have the white robe, walking with him and sitting with him on the throne, and will reign with him forever and ever. And whatever tears we have, the tears of suffering and the tears of all the road, the thorny road we're walking, it says we'll wipe all tears away from us And he'll give us that reward of the conqueror, the reward of the overcomer. We overcome the flesh. We overcome lust of the flesh. We overcome spiritual death. We overcome spiritual stagnancy. We overcome all the deadness of the world trying to impose itself on us. We overcome the idleness. We overcome the tiredness. We overcome all the weariness. And we're up and doing. We rise. We're awake. We stir ourselves up. And we move on in the work of the Lord. And we have listening ears. We have circumcised ears. We have obedient ears. We have respectful ears. We have ears that honor the word of the Lord. And we have ears that will quickly take that word and go and give to all members of our church. He that has an ear, let him hear. That's me, that's you. Let him hear, let us hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. A reward even here on earth, a reward in heaven, a reward from the eternal is waiting for us. A reward every faithful leader, every faithful minister, every faithful angel of the church in Sardis, angel of the church in Ephesus, angel of the church in Smyrna, angel of the church in Pergamos, angel of the church in Thyatira, angel of the church in Philadelphia, angel of the church in Laodicea, if we will have ears to hear and obedient to the word of the Lord himself will reward us with all he has promised. Tell the Lord, as the Spirit of God wakes you up, will not go back to slumbering, to sleeping, to dying, to death again. Remain alive in the Lord, active in the Lord, dependable, trustworthy, undefiled, unblameable, obedient to the calling and the commission the Lord has put in your hand. Jesus' name we pray. Father, we do thank you for your goodness. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your faithfulness. Spirit of the living God, we thank you for your inspiration and illumination. We thank you for the understanding you have given us. And we thank you for speaking the word straight directly to every heart. We pray, Lord, that your word, your spirit will awaken every one of us, and all the weakness and all the slumbering and all the sleeping and all the spiritual death trying to attach itself unto us, wipe and wash everything away in Jesus' name. We pray, Lord, as we are awakened, we remain active, awakened, alive in Jesus' name. And the work you have given us to do, we'll do it with all the strength, with all the power, with all the spiritual enablement you have granted us tonight. We pray, Lord, the spirit of life and the spirit of truth and the spirit of power and the spirit of wisdom and the spirit of holiness and the spirit of glory and the spirit of grace will abide upon every one of us. And like the wind you blow on us, refresh us. We pray like fire you burn and make us fervent. We pray like water you will refresh us and you will make us come alive as the dew on the water of heaven. The Spirit comes upon us. And as a dove, you come upon us and make us gentle and make us meek and make us to have the lowliness we ought to have as servants of the Lord. And we pray, Lord, like the fire that you burn within us. We pray, Lord, that you'll not leave us alone. And your Spirit, complete Spirit, perfect Spirit, will so refresh in us and will be the man of God, the woman of God that we ought to be in Jesus' name. We're asking, Lord, that your truth will be deep in us. Your grace, Spirit of grace, will abide fully in us. And we pray, Lord, your glory will abide on us. We pray that the seal of the Spirit will be upon us, energize us everywhere we go, will not be found wanting. Minister to us, not just now, keep on ministering unto us, putting us on our feet that will be what you have called us to be. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen.